What's shaking, cocktail fans? I'm Modern Bar Cart CEO Eric Koslick. It's my job to hit the road and track down the best and brightest minds in the spirits and cocktail world so that I can share their secrets with you. This time around, I visit vintage glassware expert Victoria Vergason at her store, The Hour, in historic Alexandria, Virginia. She walks us through some of the major trends and changes in glassware styles during different periods of the 20th century, and then we chat about her new line of glassware and bar tools called the Modern Home Bar. Check it out. And we're back here at The Hour with Victoria Vergason. And Victoria, you're about to take us through kind of a little history lesson.
A little time warp here.
Exactly, yeah. Using these beautiful vintage pieces from your shop.
Yeah, these are kind of indicative of kind of what happened during the 20th century with barware and glassware, and the things that I speak to me, but because they tell a story. And the first thing that I probably want to start with is this gorgeous Prohibition era cocktail shaker. And I often have a lot of people come into the store, this big tall beauty, and ask me, well, what is that? And I'm like, that's a cocktail shaker. And they're like, doesn't look like a cocktail shaker. And I immediately say, well, that's the whole point, because it it was made during Prohibition. And in Prohibition, you did not want to announce that you were drinking in the house. And so they often made their cocktail shakers to look like teapots.
Wow.
Or coffee pots. And so they're wonderful because they originally they were made, a lot of the real beauties are sterling and silver plate. For those of us who, you know, were not rich enough to have
right.
the staff to support all the polishing that would take place, chrome was also a common feature that was very popular during the 1920s, and since we're almost 100 years out, you know, basically the ingredients would be poured into the top, and as you can see, there's a built-in strainer where the nozzle comes out.
All right, just like a permanent cobbler strainer type deal.
And after you would shake, you would truly unscrew the top cap and pour through the spout.
Right.
Just like you'd pour coffee, but it wasn't coffee.
Right.
And one of the things that I love about this picture in particular is it tells the story about Prohibition, but it also tells another story, and that was during the late 20s was when the Empire State Building was being erected, and most of the pictures that you find that are early 20s are about two-thirds the size of this one.
Yeah.
And with the Empire State Building being erected, a lot of the barware followed suit. So you started having elongated pitchers and shakers, and it really kind of dates a piece, if you're lucky enough to find one, kind of when the product was made. Often they'll be marked on the bottom of who made them. Some are not, because we were prolific in producing glassware and barware throughout the 20th century. So this is a great representation of what was happening during Prohibition.
Yeah, and what is this? This has to be like 2 liters.
Oh, easily, yeah. This is party size.
Yeah, it is.
This is Gatsby. I mean, yeah, you might have a sterling one, but you know, for those wanting to throw their own parties at home, this was a beauty, and still is, and still is usable, and is such a treat and a conversation piece if somebody had this in their home bar. That's the whole point, is kind of bringing these stories back and making them fresh and kind of creating your own stories with them.
Right, and I could totally, the cool thing is, I mean, if you put this next to a regular shaker and you put a piece, one of those 2-inch large ice cubes next to a regular ice cube, it's about, the scale kind of matches. So if I were gonna shake up a drink in this, I would just use big ice.
Yeah, yeah.
And
as you know, the nice thing about metals is it really retains the cold temperature.
Right.
So, and they get frosty looking, and they're fabulous to use and pour with.
Absolutely. So what other pieces do we have on this
table?
So
another kind of fun one that I love to talk about is a piece that was designed by Napier. Napier is a costume jewelry company. And during Prohibition, also, you know, was the age of Art Deco. and 1925 World Expo in Paris, kind of was where it all came out. And Napier had a bunch of designers who made beautiful bar pieces. It was also the machine age was going on, and a lot of the pieces that Napier designed were mechanical in nature. So their designers kind of happened because of World War II, and kind of after, between World War I and World War II, during the war efforts, Napier would stop their jewelry production and would join the war effort and start making bullet casings and other things with using metals. Well, in the 20s, they had all these wonderful designers, and they were like, you know, Prohibition's going on. We're going to also be making some really cool products in addition to the bullet casing. So they created a bunch of very interesting and kind of interesting bar tools, but conversation pieces. So this one, it's a great step jigger. And if you notice, it has this handle and this funky base.
Yeah.
And when you pour your spirits to measure, you would place it either over the shaker or over the glass. And when you press the handle.
Oh, no kidding.
The spirit would pour out the bottom. So it was a whole idea. They're called press and release shakers, or press and release jiggers. And they were this simple mechanical piece that served a function.
Wow.
Were incredibly stylish. They date back to the machine age, kind of the end of the industrial age, or the beginning of the industrial age. And yet they're totally usable and totally fun to work with.
Look at that.
And they're getting harder and harder to find. Napier did a couple of pieces that are just very... whimsical, but they all had a design element to them that are just fabulous to collect.
It's so simple and elegant, and I'll be honest, it does look, you know, you say that there's this connection with like the munitions. It feels a little bit like a trigger mechanism.
Yeah. No, they were, yeah, you can, it's, they're, they, again, to me, a cocktail, the whole thing about the cocktail hour is it should be an all-encompassing sensory experience. It really should, you know, you should be able to hear the ice shake, hear the handle being released, you know, how it feels in your hand.
Yeah, it doesn't, you know, like it's got a handle, and yet when you try and hold this thing like a traditional handle, it doesn't feel right at all.
No. It's meant to be held like a jigger.
Yeah.
That you just, you press the handle in.
It also has a bit of like a cuckoo clock like sensibility with it, of like it's just a simple on or off, like there's two modes, and wow, I've never seen one of these before. I'm obsessed. Instant obsession.
They did a similar one, and instead of just being a jigger, they put I have one downstairs, they put a spoon at the bottom of it. So when you press the handle, the spirit would run down the spoon, and you would then stir. If you were stirring instead of shaking, so
you could use that.
So anyway, there were these wonderful timepieces that happened in the 20s and 30s in barware that are just wonderful to have in the house even today, and they stand the test of time.
They do, and one of the things that occurs to me is as I'm thinking about like trends in contemporary glassware. That, let's be fair, I'm not an expert, but I do peruse a lot of glassware. It is something I'm interested in if I don't know a lot about it. There's delight built into this in a way that I don't see delight being taken into account as much these days.
That's exactly right. I said everything, and that again goes back to the whole story of how the not only did the 20th century was known for its changes for the cocktail, but it also changed glassware and barware. And well, I'll talk about that in just a second. I'm going to move on to our third piece I'm going to show you, and that is this simple and very exquisite little cocktail glass with a hand-painted rooster on it. And the rooster was one of the motifs that was very popular during the early part of the 20th century. And it was the cocktail for the cocktail hour.
Right.
And you would you'd often find them depicted on pieces. I often have this glass is probably about a 3 ounce, maybe 3.5 ounce glass, small V-shaped with a foot, for those of you who can't see it. And I have a lot of folks that come in the store and say, you know, what are you going to serve in that? It's kind of small. And I can tell by looking at a glass and by shapes like this that these were made pretty much pre-World War II.
Mm-hmm.
And they're made doing something called the Rules of Three. And the Rules of Three basically say that cocktail glasses were typically about 3 ounce measures. They typically contain cocktail ingredients were about 3 ingredients. And the whole idea is you would drink them in 3 sips because you didn't want your cocktail getting warm. And we didn't have huge refrigerators and ice being made all the time. And the whole idea was that you would, as a hostess or host, you would be refreshing your guests' drinks and conversing with them as you were doing so. But it's also how, interestingly enough, the three martini lunch came about. Because the three martinis were this small size scale.
Right.
And they're not the scale that we kind of became accustomed to towards the latter part of the 20th century, but they were really small scale glasses.
Right, and one of the things that you'll see if you come to visit the hour is that there's a lot of pitchers here as well, and pitchers are something that has, at least as far as I've seen, really not made a comeback whatsoever in the bar scene.
It's baffling to me because they're one of the main bar tools for any home bar.
Right.
And I often have folks coming in and saying, you know, where's that mixing glass? And I'm like, what, you like the Japanese mixing glass?
The Yarai,
that's a new thing. That is something that we developed recently. The Japanese did have mixing glasses. But really, throughout the mid-century, you know, they were these tall, slender pitchers. And they were called cocktail pitchers or mixing. Originally, they were mixing tins. They were, you know, metal in nature. And then they became, you know, cocktail pitchers, and they were often referred to as martini pitchers because that's what often the cocktail that was being made. But they really, you know, folks come in and they don't understand that these were the original cocktail pitchers.